Vale. Bueno, pues empiezo yo. Buenos días a todos. Bueno, decir que para mí es un orgullo, la verdad, presentar esta charla, esta conferencia y sobre todo presentar a su ponente, que es Anton Guimerà. Creo que Anton Guimerà lo conocéis casi todos en el CNM porque tiene una larga trayectoria de trabajo y de investigación en el CNM y concretamente en el GAP, porque entró como ingeniero técnico en el año 2000. Yo ayer, repasándolo lo del año, lo tuve que mirar dos veces porque no me lo podía creer, han pasado ya casi 21 años, y os puedo asegurar que el aspecto de Anton sigue siendo igual. Es decir, no ha perdido ni la coleta con la que llegó aquel primer día. Ha seguido manteniéndola. Bueno, pues a partir de allí, como ingeniero técnico, Anton se incorporó en todos los trabajos que íbamos realizando de aplicaciones biomédicas, de dispositivos, sobre todo basados en la monitorización de la bioimpedancia, y de allí participó un productor que estaban relacionados con la isquemia reperfusión cardíaca, con trasplante de órganos, y él se encargaba de ir desde el electrodo hasta el dispositivo final, que en muchas ocasiones acababa en un ensayo clínico, ¿no? Entonces se fue conociendo y adquiriendo conocimientos en todo este campo de aplicaciones biomédicas. En el 2006 opositó y ganó la plaza de funcionario de técnico superior o técnico especialista, siempre me lío con estas plazas, de técnico superior especializado OPI. Pero, a pesar de seguir trabajando y de estar involucrado en estos proyectos, parece ser que el tema le gustó lo suficiente como para seguir formándose académicamente. Y siguió haciendo ingeniería electrónica y acabó haciendo el doctorado en el 2013 con premio extraordinario de la UAB. Su línea de investigación, siguiendo todo esto, siempre ha sido las propiedades eléctricas de los tejidos y su manera más o menos de monitorizarla con electrodos que, dado que está en el CNM, ha sido un sitio donde ha podido mejorarlos, fabricarlos y caracterizarlos. De ahí su experiencia en desarrollar electrodos con platino negro, nanotubos de carbono. Pues una línea que para él parecía que le era como muy fácil, cuando todos los demás, cada vez que nos hablaban de temas de impedancia o similares, yo a mí todavía se me ponen los pelos de punta, pero para él ha sido un tema que le ha sido como muy fácil desarrollar. Con este background, y la aparición del grafeno como material 2D, que ofrecía una serie de ventajas que podía dar un valor muy importante a todos estos electrodos que estábamos fabricando, hubo como un punto de inflexión tanto en su carrera como en la del propio GAF, ¿no? Y yo diría que han sido tres factores fundamentales por lo que esta línea es lo que es hoy día. Y estos tres factores para mí han sido, por un lado, el haber estado en proyectos europeos, que en algunos de ellos, y sobre todo en los últimos, Anton Guimerà y HLIP de dichos proyectos europeos, el estar participando en unos proyectos emblemáticos como es el Flash Chip Europeo, el tener a Anton Guimerà propiamente una colaboración que yo diría muy sinérgica y diría que también envidiable, con el profesor José Antonio Garrido del ICN2, y sobre todo, la tercera diría que el otro factor es estar rodeado de gente multidisciplinar que es la que está haciendo de pilón para tirar adelante esta línea. Y podría nombrar y quiero nombrar a tecnólogos como Xavi Illa, a químicos como Sergi o la Eli, o a electrónicos como el Eduard, a Javier, al Enrique, y bueno, no quiero seguir nombrando, quizás Anton os los nombrará luego, pero que creo que son un pilón fundamental en la línea esta que se va a desarrollar. Diría que esta línea es una línea que ahora es identificaria del GAP y creo que será en el futuro la línea más identificaria del GAP, y que por otro lado es considerado actualmente como un referente ya europeo en lo que son los transistores de grafeno aplicados a aplicaciones médicas y en concreto interfaces neurales aplicadas en neurociencias, que es el tema que os va ahora a contar Anton Guimerà. Yo diría que toda esta línea que se debe a la manera de hacer de Anton, a la manera de liderar, aunque él no lo crea, pero que sí que lidera, pero sobre todo con dos factores más. Su manera de trabajar muy duro, su manera de tener ilusión y su honestidad, que es uno de los factores fundamentales que, de la manera de ser de Anton, y que no solo es en el trabajo, sino en la manera social, cuando, por ejemplo, todos los años nos ofrece esa calzotada en su casa de San Martín de Sarroca, ¿vale? Que este año no la hemos podido hacer y que espero que el año que viene sí que la podamos hacer. Eso implica que todos estamos con salud y todos hemos pasado por este bache de la pandemia y que ahora, pues eso, os deseo a todos salud y que disfrutéis de la charla que va a dar Anton a continuación. Nada más, besos a todos.
Bueno, gracias. Gracias, Rosa, por esta introducción. No sé qué decir. Bueno, I'm going to present the work that we have done during the last 5 years, more or less, on the top of developing neural interfaces based on flexible graphene transistors. As Rosa said, this work has been done in collaboration with a group of José Antonio Garrido at the ICN2, and also in the framework of different European projects. The most relevant ones is the Graphene Flagship and the BrainCom. And this allows us to collaborate with international neuroscientist groups that help us a lot in the validation of the technology and also in finding the better ways to understand the needs and also to take profit from the unique capabilities of the graphene transistors. Why neural interfaces? Why they are used? Neural interfaces are used in different parts of the body with different applications, and the main of those applications could be the discovery of therapeutic biomarkers for following the treatment of several diseases, and also for identify the severity of that diseases and the origin, such as the Parkinson, the Alzheimer, epilepsy, or other ones. Another big use or topic of the neural interfaces is the restoring of lost capabilities in the field of the neuroprosthesis. These losing capabilities could be due to a stroke, blind, a spinal cord injury, or all these lost capabilities that can be restored by interfacing with the neural system. And the other topic, and also very important, due to the lack of knowledge in the behavioral of the brain, is fundamental understanding of brain and its diseases. There is a lot of applications in animal research or in animal models for a better understanding of the neural behavior. And this is a lot of fields where neural interfaces can play, and this is the main motivation for this work. To monitor the brain activity, the brain activity, it spans over a wider scale of spatiotemporal ranges, from microseconds to hours, and also in a wide spatial range, from the single ion neuron membrane to the full brain activity. Due to this complexity, there is a lot of tools to monitor that activity, some based on electrical activity, other on optical recordings, or on magnetic fields recordings. And each of those ones cover one part of this spatiotemporal scale. There is any technique that is able to cover the full spatiotemporal scale over the brain activity takes place. One of the most important tools to monitor the brain activity is the electrophysiological based ones that is due to the electrical nature of the brain activity. And among these electrophysiological tools, we can highlight the EEG, which is the less invasive one, which consists in place electrodes on the skull of the human and record activity. This is less invasive, but it's used a lot in clinical applications due to this less invasiveness. However, the quality of the signal recorded, it's very poor due to the filtering of the skull on the signal generated on the brain. To obtain more relevant information on the brain, we need to place the electrodes or the transducers closer to the origin of the signals in the brain. In this case, we can differentiate between the implants, which are placed in the deep in the cortical tissue, and it's very invasive, but the signal quality that we can record in these kind of devices is very high. In an intermediate way, we can identify the echo or micro-echo devices that are placed on the top of the cortex surface. And it's less invasive, and the information that we can record is also very relevant. The most part of the work that we have developed is in the role of micro-echo technology, devices to be placed on the surface of the cortex. The main challenges that the neural interfaces have, or the main challenges for that devices, in one hand, we have the biocompatibility. When we implant any foreign body in the tissue or in the human body or in the body, there is a glial encapsulation. There is a reaction of the body against that strange object, and this produces a hamper on this quality on the time. There is another big topic, which is the signal quality, which is it's currently limited by the noise of the devices and also by the frequency response of the devices used to record that activity. And the final big topic for the neural interfaces is the connectivity. If we want to increase the number of recording sites, there is a bottleneck in the connection between those electrodes and the external electronics. In the work that I am going to present, the most important topics that we tackle is the signal quality and the connectivity. And to tackle the signal quality, which is the first topic, how we can improve the signal quality of neural interfaces, typically or historically, in the development of neural interfaces are based on metallic electrodes, and the improvement of those metallic electrodes is based on increase its surface area, being more important the study of materials with high surface ratios and porous materials to implement those electrodes. However, here we are interested in a novel transducer, which is the graphene-based solution-gated field effect transistor, which is an active device that is also able to catch the activity of the neurons, which modulates the current that flows through the channel, which is made by graphene. Why use graphene in these kind of devices? From one side, we have the high mobility of graphene, and in the other side, we have the fact that is very stable, is very chemically stable in water solutions. This allows us to work directly in interaction with the tissue without the need to use any kind of the electric to protect the semiconductor material and the tissue. This relies or this results in a higher coupling capacitance, and together with a high carrier mobility, give us a more transconductance value, which is the intrinsic gain of the device, than in comparison with other materials that can be used to implement this kind of devices. To test this, to start with evaluation of this novel transducer in a real scenario, we have to develop a flexible technology based on these graphene devices to take profit also from the flexibility of the graphene that is able to adapt the final interface to the surface of the brain, being closer to the origin of the signal. In terms of the technology, the main figure of merit of these devices is the noise, the intrinsic noise that our devices have. That noise is mainly originated by charge trapping on the surface or on the between the channel and the gate, that with the different time constant that these charge traps have, exhibits a 1/f noise. This 1/f noise, or the evolution of the of this 1/f noise over the given frequency band of the neural signals, give us the IRMS noise of the device that have a dependency on the bias point or the transconductance on the bias point that we operate that device. And finally, by normalizing this value by the transconductance of the device, which is the intrinsic gain of the device, we obtain the minimal signal that we can detect with our devices. That currently, it's more or less in the range of the 5-10 microvolts. To implement the, this technology, a very important point is how we contact the graphene with the metal tracks. To do this contact, we have developed or we have studied the impact of how we can improve that by applying ozone treatment on the contacts, which clean the resist the residues of the fabrication process or the lithography process, and also introduces some defects on the graphene on that side. And this it's resulted in a lower contact resistance between the metal and the graphene, and this relies in a higher transconductance for our devices, and also it's reflected on lower noise values for the device. Another important point for the behavior of the devices in the recording mode or to record the neural activity is how the signal from the brain tissue is coupled to the channel. And this we can compare this with a normal technology, which is based on electrodes. In an electrode-based technology, the impedance of the electrode is placed on in series with an amplifier. And this leads to a voltage divider that results in an attenuation at lower frequency bands. And however, in the case of the graphene transistors, the capacitance of the this component here, the capacitance of the electrical lower layer of the electrode is placed, it forms part intrinsically of the device. And this allows us to achieve a stable gain even at lower frequency ranges. And this is very important to expand the signal, the recording signal to those frequencies. Another important point for the characterization of the devices and also to achieve a good quality recording is that the device the response of the graphene transistors is nonlinear. And this has to be it has been studied and have to be characterized and taken into account to achieve high quality recordings. And being not linear, that happens is that it introduces some kind of harmonic distortion that we have characterized in order to determine which is the better point to polarize our devices. And from our studies, we have observed that there is a point around 0.1 lower than the charge neutrality point where the distortion is lower. This point of the calibration to take into account all the non-idealities of the device, like the signal distortion and also the frequency response that could be not stable for all the frequencies due to some contaminants on the surface of the graphene, have to be taken into account to when we use this device in our real applications. And we have to apply different kind of calibrations and corrections to achieve a high fidelity recordings with our devices. An important point, as I said before, is the capability of these devices to record lower frequencies than electrodes due to this special coupling that I have explained before. Another point that hampers the quality of the recordings of low frequency, or that we can call DC coupled recordings when we use electrodes, is the high common voltages that appears in the electrodes when they're operated in a DC couplet, and also that some drift and artifacts that hamper the quality of the recording in a DC mode. However, due to the chemical stability of the graphene, we can achieve with graphene a very stable recording a long time without drifts and without artifacts. And this opens the door to explore infra-slow brain activity, which cannot be recorded with electrode technology and micro electrode side. The gold standard to record this kind of activity is the glass micropipettes, which consist in a glass tube with a silver chloride electrode inside. The drawback of this device is that cannot be used to do a mapping, can only be used in single point or few points measurements in the brain. Taking into account all of that, we have studying the recording of cortical spring depolarization events, which consist in a large signal resulting from the depolarization of the membranes of the neuron membranes that results in a high voltage signal that is related with some injuries in the brain. This cortical spring depolarization can be induced by applying KCL in a certain point of the brain, and this triggers these signals. And we have developed a work comparing the quality of our recordings with the electrodes and also with the glass micropipette. And we can determine that the quality of the recording doing by our device is the same as with the gold standard. And we are able to map this infra-slow activity on the brain in several sites that cannot be done with other technologies. And here we can see, I have a video here, but it seems that not work. Yeah, I have a video here, but I cannot work it. Yeah, we can do a mapping of that activity. Why is important these low frequency signals in the field of the neuroscience or to study some diseases? Normally, in the frequency spectrum, the brain activity is split in different kind of activities, and the electrodes, the normally used electrodes, are only able to record the signals above 1 hertz of that activity, which is the LFP, the high frequency oscillation, or the moon. However, with our technology, we can record the lower part of this frequency band. And here we can see a nice example of an epileptic seizure that, when is recorded with a normal technology, which is high pass filtered, both seizures looks like the same. However, when we record it with our technology, we can observe that both seizures has not the same DC components or the same low frequency components, and this helps in the understanding of the origin of that diseases. We have also developed a penetrating technology, an implant technology, to record this activity in the cortex, in the deeper layers of the cortex. And we have also observed that this low frequency activity have different patterns in function of the layers of the cortex, which is also relevant for the study of the origin of these seizures, of these behavior, of these diseases. And also, it's important to show that the information that we can catch, apart from the low frequency bands, we are we are always able to record high frequency oscillation related with this epileptic activity. In a next step of the development of our technology, right now we can say that we have a very stable technology with high yields and very reproducible process. And this was able to be, are starting to be used by some groups, by our collaborations, to start to study those phenomena, those diseases or those investigations to extract valuable information. In this case, I'm going to present here the last work that we have done, in where the objective is not yet not the technology validation, it's the information that our devices are able to extract from the biological point of view. In this case, we are able to record a lot of CSD events, and we have been able to do a classification and a better characterization of these kind of events. Yeah, to change the topic, the other big topic on the neural interfaces developing is the connectivity bottleneck. If we are using electrodes, which is just single terminal devices, we have to use one line, metal line, for each device. This leads, or this results, that even the technology fabrication is able to define very small features of these electrodes. At the end, the bottleneck is in the connection of those electrodes to the recording electronics. For this, the use of graphene transistors or the transistors configurations can be assembled in an array-like matrix, and it's able to apply multiplexing strategies for reduce the connectivity of those lines, of those devices. In that line, and to test these capabilities, we have developed a metal layers flexible technology to construct these array-like neural interfaces based on graphene transistors. Here, to do that, we use two metal layers, as I said, and we are able to define a metal bias to interconnect those metal lines and assemble on top of that the graphene transistors to implement these multiplexing strategies. To implement the readout of these array-like matrices or of those multiplexed matrices, we are exploring two kind of readout strategies. One is more commonly used, which is the time division multiplexing, which consists in scanning each row of our matrix to reconstruct the final signal. And another one, it's based on the frequency division multiplexing, where in that case, all the sides of the array are biased and working linearly without any interruption. And the information is coded by the different frequency bands that we apply to each column of the array. Each of those approaches has his own drawbacks and benefits, and we are exploring which of these ones are the better one to scale up the technology. These two different approaches for readout the signal, the brain signal with multiplexing arrays, have been validated in vivo with a small arrays, just 8x8, which results in 64 sites with just 16 wires. And both of them has been able to perform and to record the brain activity. And also it's important to highlight that the capability to record infra-slow activity is preserved even we are using a multiplexing readout strategies. To continue with the work and scaling up to 1,000 channels that we are expecting to be released in few time, we are collaborating with a group of ICAS to develop an ASIC able to record to implement both multiplexing readout technologies in a small ASIC and able to construct a small electronics to be compatible with the requirements of the applications to record the activity from that devices. And just to finish the presentation and this summary of the work, we have also validated the long-term stability of our devices in a first approaches, and we have found that we have found very promising results, as we are able to record the brain activity over 6 months on devices implanted on rats. And here we can observe how with these devices we are able to record the visual evoked response over this period of time without losing signal quality, which is very promising for continuing with this technology and continuing studying the capabilities for long-term recordings. And as a final summary of the work developed during these years, the main conclusion that we can extract is that the graphene technology or the graphene transistors are able to cover a part of this complex spatiotemporal map of the brain activity, no, that is not covered by other technologies. And this is the case of the lower frequency range. And this is a very valuable tool for the neuroscientists to explore the information contained in this zone. And also the information contained in this frame of the spatiotemporal scale of the brain activity is in the same time resolution as other techniques like fMRI techniques, and it's very valuable to compare the electrophysiology information and that frequency bands with the information obtained with other techniques. And this is more or less the summary of the work that we have been done during these last years. And also, I would like to thank to the clean room staff here at the CNM that helps a lot in the establish all the process steps and all the process the fabrication processes that we need to develop this technology and to achieve these results. And thank you for the attention. And if you have any question, we can tackle that.
Thank you, Anton. It was a really good presentation. I think it tackled the main issues and questions we had about how these graphene transistors work. So thank you very much. And yes, we are opening now the session for the debate. So if you have any questions, you can open your microphones or you can write it down on the chat and I will read it out loud. So any volunteer for the first question?
Hello, this is Luis. Thanks, Anton, for the talk. You said that in the last slide, you said you are working for large area and high density. So can you put numbers here? So how large is the patch, so to say? And what the application demands? It will be better to have a much larger patch, or it doesn't matter because you want to tap the brain in an area where the activity is, and you know that it's just 1 centimeter per 1 centimeter.
Here it's a complex question, and I can try to explain. In terms of demands, the demands are very huge because the ideal world is to do a mapping of all the sites of the brain. And regarding the numbers that we are achieving and where are the state of the art, more or less, in the BrainCom, we are trying to develop thousands of recording sites, and we ambition to cover the most part of the hemisphere of one rad. Here, as you said, the pitch, the desired pitch is related with the neuron size, and the discussion in the field, it says that more or less the pitch, the desired pitch should be around 10 microns of the recording site, as separated 10 microns, more or less, in the resolution of the 10 microns, which is the size of the neurons. And regarding the large, the coverage area, it depends a lot of the application, because it's different developing things for rat or rodent studies, which the size of the brain is very small, to develop things for human scale or larger animals. No? Here, the requirements for the large coverage, it's more wider, because you need to cover more areas of the brain. And here is where this development to scale up the number of sites is have more sense, because you need to cover large areas, and it's more useful than maybe, because with the current technology, we think in a rat mind or a rodent brain, we are able right now, I think that we are able to cover the full one hemisphere fully covered by with dense speech. I don't know if this answered the question well.
Yeah. You're looking for 1,000, you said?
We have developed right now. We have tested, fully tested the matrices with 64 channels in multiplexing operations with 8x8 wires. We have partially tested the devices of 2,000 channels. We have fabricated and tested, this is the results, and we chose highly yield of 600 devices. We are finishing the fabrication of the 1,000 devices per probe. And in collaboration with Vikas, we are ready to test. We are in the last sprint to test the ASIC to record all those signals. We have, with the discrete electronics that we have used for the previous studies, we are able to test up to 200 channels. And we have more or less tested this and works well. To go ahead, we need the incorporation of the ASIC in the readout, because if not, we cannot manage that large number of channels.
Okay, thank you.
I think that
a short question from my side. This is Joan. Of course, these transistors have all the specificities of graphene, which is actually what enables the application, as far as I understand. But the device is essentially the same as the as it is for silicon, the ISFET. Is this correct?
Yeah, it's the basics of that. It's, as you said, is more or less the same as an ISFET. The difference is that we don't need the insulation layer.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the device itself. It's quite easy. It's just a graphene flake or a graphene square contacted by two contact metals and passivated to define the channel. And due to the stability, because we have a large water window, and we can ensure that in the operation range there is no electrochemical reactions, we can operate it without insulation layer.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Clear, thank you.
Thank you, John. I think Francesc Xavier Pérez has raised his hand.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Anton, for the presentation, and congratulations to you and your group for these wonderful works. Okay, so we have recently seen you in the news with this huge investment to this company. So maybe you can comment a little bit about this and say if there is some relation with this technology and the company, and what is it about?
Yeah, right now the company has no relation with this technology yet. We are in negotiations to incorporate this technology to the company. The idea of the company is translate this technology, all the graphene-based technology, to human scale. Right now, the company is based on another technology, which is developed at ICN2, which is the ignite electrodes, which is another approach. It's in the world of the electrodes with a high porously material to improve the performance of the electrodes. And the idea of the company is translate this technology to human scale, because the work done to translate this technology or any technology to human market is the regulatory pathway. You need to ensure a lot of work on the biocompatibility, regulatory clearance work, scalability, which is a work that is very hard to do in the framework of research centers, and have to be supported by other approaches.
Yeah, actually, I mean, this was also another question I had. It's about the biocompatibility. I mean, all the materials that you are using now are biocompatible?
In principle, yes. In principle, we expect that regarding the transistors operation, the main drawback of to translate it to humans is the fact that right now we are operating in a DC coupled way. I mean, the signal is coupled in DC, and also the bias is in DC way. And this hampers a bit the electrical safety operation. We have some work done to overpass this drawback to scale up to humans. And this is the main reason or this is the point to make it difficult to translate to humans, or this means that the work to translate to humans should be a little bit higher than if we are working with electrodes. Also, because all the electronics that are working in the clinician side are based on electrodes. I mean, if we are developing electrodes, it's very easy to translate, because you need just to ensure the compatibility of your device. And the electronic recording instrumentation, you can use the normal one that it's already developed. However, here, as we are developing another, we have developed also the acquiring electronics, because it's not the same device. And this makes this more difficult to be translate, or need more work to translate, because you need also to regulate these electronics.
But in one of the images that you show, I think in one of a rat, I saw a platinum iridium. Platinum iridium is also biocompatible?
Yeah, this is a very interesting question. You mean here, no? The platinum iridium is for another stuff. The big point is that currently, to ensure the stability, the part of the stability that I commented to that enables us to record infra-slow activity is due to the stability of the graphene itself. However, in the role of the stability, there is another big component on the channel, which is the reference electrode. And that reference electrode right now, or the one that we are using, it's silver chloride, as you pointed, and it's not biocompatible at all. However, here there is a lot of work on the side that we can reuse. We have not reused it right now because we have other problems, but we are aware that in the field of ESFETs, it has been developed a lot of good reference electrodes in a safety way. And in the case that we need to translate this to humans or to more biocompatible sites, we plan to explore the use of those electrodes.
Okay, thank you.
Anton, news like the ones that we could read yesterday about face masks containing being recalled from the market, is are a problem for you people that work with graphene? Are you ready to answer the question if graphene is safe for humans?
I don't know. Here, let's say that here, in the case of our devices, the amount of graphene that we have is very little, because at the end it's just one graphene flake of CVD graphene, just one atom thick, that it's in the middle of a polyimide device. So the amount of graphene that we really use in the final device is very small. And also that I heard in the news is that it's due to the breathing of that flakes. Mm-hmm. And I expect that this don't happen here. But let's say that in the framework of the graphene flagship, there is one package. I don't remember exactly which is the number of the package. I think that is World Package 6. That it's fully focused on the safety of that material. And it also tackle all the problems in the case of a fabrication, large scale fabrication of graphene flakes for graphene oxide. I mean, there is a work done in that sense to ensure the safety and also the safety of the fabrication process of the graphene at large scales. Yeah. So maybe that people are more able than me to answer that question.
Okay, it's not only safety, but the people's perception of safety.
Yeah, this is a big trouble. I don't know. This is the world that we live. But here I don't see too much problem, as I said before, because we are not